So I've got a sort of background in not just geography, but in public policy for the last 30 odd years, and particularly specialising in crime and local criminal justice systems. That's been an area I've loved, and particularly the question of governance of criminal justice. I love local government too. I'm a councillor at county and district level, so I love my local government. But the interface between local government with a small L, small G, and criminal justice, I think, is utterly fascinating and a really rather under-researched area. So when the idea of police and crime commissioners sort of hit the policy agenda of the Conservatives back in, I suppose it was about 2010, wasn't it? Fairly shortly after the last election. I was immediately interested. I've done a lot of work, research and consultancy with police authorities that existed before, and I had very strong views about how useless they were at providing good governance of policing, a really important area for good governance. My eyes lit up a little bit, thought, hey, this is interesting, and spent the next 2 years sort of gearing up to look quite closely and I hope critically at what this model represents. And that's really what today's little talk is about, a summation of my investigation of the very early years of this new model of police governance. But as John has just said, a week in politics is a long time. And just as there was a possibility for the last 6 months at least, that if we had a Labour government, we'd be saying goodbye to this area of governance, although no indication quite of what would be put in its place. But indeed, I had a large ESRC application in, and the main reason we didn't get it was because it was uncertain. The referees, all of them, picked up on that point. It was a well-regarded proposal, but the referee's advice was it was too unsure what the durability of the model was, so didn't really want to invest in it. So in a sense, things have settled from last week in that we can now, at least for the next 4 or 5 years, expect a degree of stability and probably consolidation in the model, because it's again a Conservative government whose baby this was. That may or may not be how it plans out in time. Also, as John said, today's announcements about devolution and so on, which have obviously been a current of thinking for a while now, but particularly we're centred on Greater Manchester, as you say, sort of introduces another sort of solidifying factor for this model, except it's done perhaps in a mayoral context, which is probably what I've always thought was the better way anyway than this. Whether it will affect the West Midlands as quickly as it's going to affect Greater Manchester remains to be seen. I doubt it somehow. The relationships in my part of the country are not so well developed and oiled as they seem to be up here. So a little bit about PCCs. I got interested, as I said, really before they started, and it was a really troubled start, I think. Indeed, to some extent, some of these problems that bugged the early period, months and so on, of commissioners still continue, I think. But certainly we started out with a disaster of an election in terms of voter turnout, claims of ignorance about what the role was, what people were expected to vote for, confusion about what the candidates represented, because they really weren't very clear, and most people, certainly our way, didn't get any information anyway. It was only on websites, and who was going to go and look for that? So a bit of a disaster on day one, really, and that hasn't improved. We've had two by-elections, as it were, since that all out. It probably wasn't helpful to have chosen a November evening. Remember, those of you who are in the know, the elections were put back to give the government more time to get it right, but they, in doing so, they got it even more wrong. And then, of course, we had all these critical headlines about the appointment of deputies and staff, election agents and the like. We had that in my area. Indeed, the Deputy Police and Crime Commissioner for West Mercia, my patch, effectively is running the show. We've got a very weak commissioner, unfortunately. It's a bit sad, really. I haven't been too critical. But it really does rile the local authority politicians that when we invite the commissioner, we get the deputy, who's just a little bit more articulate, but actually has no democratic legitimacy at all. And there are plenty of other examples of that having been a local problem too. Much attention and critical attention about the cost of it all, that the idea that this would save money clearly has been questioned quite savagely in some cases. I don't know whether any of you saw the TV revelations from Anne Barnes. I only saw bits of it actually, but I knew it was coming and I knew it was going to be an embarrassment. So that was a story. We've had a whole succession of fallouts almost from day one, and they still continue. And the Rotherham problem, of course, was Sean Wright and the denial of a problem. He stayed on too long as Police and Crime Commissioner for South Yorkshire. He, of course, having been the chair of Social Care Board at the time of the beginnings of the prosecutions and so on. So just a sort of little few snaps of reminder really about the those criticisms. As I say, money has been an issue. I think there are many people who are thinking that the appointment of or the election of one Police and Crime Commissioner would save an awful lot of money in doing governance single-handedly. And I don't think anybody has really bottomed this one out yet, but certainly the BBC's little survey suggested something different, and that has, as I say, been a point of much criticism and still is in many areas, what it actually costs to have this model. But I don't think that's actually a terribly important argument, because this is police governance. It needs to be done well. And if it takes a lot more staff support then to do it well, then so be it. There's Anne Barnes, who in that film, I did see this clip where she really couldn't answer the question, well, what do you do? And that was the most embarrassing moment, I think, apart from her rather flighty sort of approach to the thing. And as you can see there, she had to apologise in the end, really, for taking part in the programme. This is one of the PCCs I've got to know quite well, Lincolnshire's PCC. That's Alan Hardwick, a journalist. He was, I think, a Lincolnshire Echo, or one of the local papers. So he knows about writing in the media and handling the media and so on well, but got himself in an awful mess very early on when he didn't like his chief constable that he'd inherited, and chose to have him suspended. And it ended up in a judicial review and cost the taxpayers a large amount of money, with the chief constable being cleared in the end. And he is now again the chief constable of Lincolnshire. Alan Hardwick lives to fight another day, still as cheerful as he looks there on the right. But nevertheless, it was quite a big story in the PCC world, as well as obviously in the Lincolnshire Press, his own newspapers. I mentioned Sean Wright, who stayed too long in his role. And this is a PCC I know well. This is Sue Mount Stevens at Avon and Somerset. I thought she was really good news. I went and interviewed her and thought she'd got some really refreshing ideas, and I think she is a good PCC, but even she has got into trouble fairly recently. And the interesting one about that one, of course, is she was one of the lucky ones. She appointed Nick Gargan as her chief constable. Most of them inherited their chief constable and had to learn to work with them. And as we all know, most chief constables weren't very keen on the idea of police and crime commissioners. So the relationships were likely to start from a frostiness. But here she was lucky enough to be able to make her own appointment, pick her person. She chose Nick, and then 2 years later she suspends him and then gets into trouble by leaking the names of in a potential prosecution case. And so it goes on. Oh, there's another one. This is Ian Johnston. This was another one that hit the national headlines as much as the local ones. He fell out with his chief constable straight away, Carmel Napier, and it is said put on pressure on her to leave, to retire. She stood her ground a bit, but that too was the subject of an investigation, and he was found to have been the bully in the case. So a poor start in the sense that all this sort of bad press made people who were already, before it happened, somewhat sceptical about police and crime commissioner type governance, feeling rather smug and, as it were, giving the sense of we told you so, we forewarned you of this. But what I want to do this evening a little bit is sort of get behind the headlines and ask a bit more about the basic concept and the experience so far of this approach, this unitary approach to police governance. I chose the title Electocracy with Accountabilities. It's actually a book chapter which has been about to come out for about 6 months now. I don't know quite why it's taking so long, but it's on its way. And I chose the title because I did a bit of dictionary searching. You know how it is. Academics like to find the word that's exactly what they want, but nobody's ever used it. Well, someone had used this one. I found this word, electocracy, which exactly captured what I think caricatures what we're talking about here. So there's an electoral system, so as it were, the public vote for their person, their preferred candidate, but once elected, they have supreme power until the next election. It's a word that's often associated these days with sort of Putin in Russia and the Thailand premier, two classic examples of where it's been used a lot. And I, the question mark's quite important at the end of this because, that's only an assertion. But the idea of that style of leadership, that style of governance, electocracy, but with this interesting idea that there clearly are some accountabilities here. And to what extent are those accountabilities effective is really what I want to talk about. Very quick reminder of the change. I don't want to dwell on this. These diagrams are probably more complicated than they need be, but what we had before the pre-2012 police governance arrangements for a long time before essentially is characterised by the triangle and the Home Office and every chief constable talked endlessly about the tripartite relationship. This was the way policing worked. So the Home Secretary had a key national interests at stake and so on. The Chief Constable was operationally in charge locally, and the police authority was the governing body, a body comprising of councillors plus some independent mixture of a few magistrates and a few great and good worthies from the locality. So a sort of half councillorship and half other interested parties acting as a governing body, the police authority. Typical, sort of local government with a small LG approach to governance. This, of course, came out of a previous period when we had a police committee, which was very much a local authority committee, but the debates at the time, back in the 60s and 70s, were very much about police out of politics. And so the police authorities were formed as separately constituted bodies. So the accountabilities with that triumphant relationship has been the sort of centrepiece of it all, was the public would, through in an indirect sense, elect their police authority, at least most of it, and the police authority would, as it were, act on behalf of the public interest. The new model, the PCC model, replaced the police authority, particularly with this individual office holder, the police and crime commissioner. Still keeping the shape of the triangle in the sense that the Home Secretary retains a strong interest in national strategic policing issues. Chief Constable still appointed to and has operational independence. The police and crime commissioner essentially picking up the role of the police authority. The slight complicating factor, the extension as it were, is some nod to the idea of local authority involvement, so that invented as a new sort of piece of the framework was a body called the Police and Crime Panel, which is made up of a representative of each local authority in the police area. But their job now is to scrutinise the Police and Crime Commissioner, not the Chief Constable. The accountability is along the axis. So the Police and Crime Panel consider the budget proposals of the Commissioner, consider the policing plan, and they have certain authorities in relation to appointments and dismissals and so on. So it's very much bounded by legislation, but a body there. So the accountability now is very much the public elect the Police and Crime Commissioner and, as it were, have that direct relationship, a more direct relationship. But the Police and Crime Panel too is sort of part of a constitutional framework, because they too are, as councillors, are members and representatives of the local public. I actually redrew that diagram. That was sort of an earlier attempt at art on this subject. I redrew this for the book chapter that's waiting to come out. I don't know if it makes it more complicated to see it written like this, but the Police and Crime Commissioner, in a sense, what I was trying to highlight here, has a series of relational accountabilities. Obviously, the accountability towards the local public. Obviously, some accountability or some relation with central government, and particularly the Home Secretary at the bottom, in two directions. The Police and Crime Panel that I've just introduced as a body that, as it were, has some responsibilities for scrutinising the police, but also to support. The legislation also talks about the panel as being a supportive body as well as a critical scrutineer. You might call it a critical friend relationship. But because these Police and Crime Commissioners are also politicians, there's an issue about sponsoring political party here, and that was, of course, was what a lot of the opposition to the idea of police governance with PCCs was all about, introducing or reintroducing direct politics and political party into the process. As I'm sure you're aware, not all the Police and Crime Commissioners are of a major party. Labour and Conservative have the majority of them. There are 12 independents that stood very much on a ticket of we're not into party politics here. But for the vast majority of them, there is somewhere in the process a sponsoring political party. And so in that sense, some potential accountability there. And down the bottom, there's a series of other relationships. Clearly, the Chief Constable and the Police Force, I've already touched on that, is a key accountability relationship with the Commissioner. The Commissioner, as it were, holding to account the Chief Constable, but also the other sort of agencies that at local level and the other partnerships and so on are also very much part and parcel of what the legislative framework demands of a Police and Crime Commissioner. So that's really just says what I have said, that I was interested to look at the nature of five accountability relationships. Five accountability relationships in looking in both directions, really, out to the voters, sideways to the Police and Crime Panel, back, as the previous diagram had it, to central government, in another direction for some to the political sponsors, and then the relationship that's sort of the other way towards the Chief Constable, or with the Chief Constable. And the way I thought about this, and as it were, went to do a piece of research, a small pilot study of a rather bigger project that was the subject of my failed ESRC application, was to try and apply the sort of ideas of principal agent theory. Are we all familiar with principal agent theory? Just in a nutshell, in case someone's not, it's really very simple. If you want to have your house decorated or a tree taken down, you'll get some quotes in, won't you, and compare quotes and make a decision about has it. You're the principal, in the sense that it's your tree or your house that wants decorating, the agent is the one that you appoint to do the job. And in the same way, economists talk endlessly about thinking about the relationships between commissioners, if you like, the principals, agents who do the work. It's obviously a very relevant theory today's contemporary public service arrangements and so on of commissioning. And two issues, again, that the economists dwell on a lot that flow from that very simple idea about principal, someone's a principal, someone else is an agent. First of all, information asymmetry. Fancy word for the idea that usually the agent has more knowledge, more information than the principal. So you want your house decorated, you think you know what you want, you can probably choose the colour, you've probably got some idea about the importance of preparation and all that, but actually the agent is much more skilled and has had much more experience. So he or she knows what sort of paints are good by and what's the, you know, how he can cut corners and all the rest of it. So there's the problem that the principal has to some extent, make some trustful judgments here take on someone that, or think about ways in which they can keep as much control as possible, scrutinising the agent at work, incentivising the agent to do the very best job, and so on and so on. That's the sort of logic of PA theory. The other problem that's highlighted there is the possibility, and it's very, very typical of most public services, that there actually isn't one principal and a series of agents and one gets the job. It's much more complicated because there are lots of agencies involved in many public service problems. We talk about multiple principals, and that's surely what we have here in this PCC governance model, multiple principals. So as I've written it here, the PCC in the electoral sense becomes the agent of the voting public. Yeah? They've chosen him or her to represent them and do governance on their behalf. So that's an agent. In that role, the PCC is an agent to the people. But in the way that I talked a minute ago about these other interesting accountability relations, they're also an agent in relation to the police and crime panels. The panel, when they're scrutinising or calling to account the police and crime commissioner because they don't like their budget or they don't like the appointment they've been recommended for a new chief constable or whatever, they are calling the shots in that sense. So again, the PCC has to persuade them and is in an agent role. Third one, the relationship with the Home Secretary is an interesting one too, because of the national security issues that the Home Secretary has authority and legislative authority, statutory powers to intervene. Again, that puts the PCCs in some agent role with the Home Office. And likewise, for those who are, as it were, standing for a political party, essentially look towards their political sponsors for a signal. Am I doing this right? Will you select me again in 2017 when the elections come round? Again, you've got the beginnings of an agency relationship there, potentially. But the other way around, right at the end, very definitely the PCC is the principal to the chief constable, and that issue of information asymmetry applies pretty well to all those, but particularly that last one, because the chief constable really does know policing, should do anyway. Been doing it for a lot of years, it's very experienced. The PCC as the politician or the independent person, now at least full time, unlike police authorities before, but nevertheless, easy to run rings round if you're a crafty chief constable. So there is always that problem, but very definitely the PCC is the principal in this case. And those that fired their chief executive, their chief constable, or chose to argue with them and so on, in a sense, are exercising their principal responsibilities there. So my task is a small piece of research as a pilot to a rather bigger study was to see to what extent these principal agent relationships were significant in practice, and how were they working out in the first couple of years. There are 41 PCCs. London doesn't have it, as has the mayor doing it, and Manchester may end up in the same way quite soon. I just chose a small sample of 9 PCCs, and it's getting a little old now. June to October is the period I sort of visited them. I also talked to the chief constables too, so I got another perspective as well. But particularly was interested to in the perspective of the PCCs, because the chief constables, I didn't think were going to tell it quite how it was. But they were quite interesting conversations too. But I chose carefully to try and get a sort of cross section. So there are no Liberal Democrat PCCs, but it was easy to find 3 Conservative, 3 Labour and 3 Independents. What have we got? 12 Independents, 16 Conservative, 13 Labour. That's the national picture at the moment. So I actually tried also to take account of the sort of different scales and geography of police forces, so a little bit of, you know, urban-rural sort of differentiation, and obviously wanted a bit of geography. Swansea geographer editor would want to infuse a bit of geography into this, so we went north, Midlands and south, and the map was roughly like that. So the blues are the 3 Conservatives, one in each of my sort of mega regions. The 3, they look orange to me from here, but they're red. Are the Labour ones, and then the purple ones are the Independents. So I didn't quite get Ormskirk into the map, but I did get to Merseyside. Jane Kennedy was one of the Labour ones there. And we went to, where did we go? Humberside is the blue one, North Wales, the Independent, and then in the Midlands section, Lincolnshire, that was Alan Hardwick that got into trouble with his chief constable. Matthew Ellis at Staffordshire, the Conservative, and the late Bob Jones in the West Midlands, who I've known for a long time. And that was a jolly interesting morning I spent with him. But sadly, he died. Indeed, he died the night after he'd just given a lecture for me at Birmingham University. And he'd arrived late. We had all this food laid out for the participants. And when I heard the news in the morning, my first thought was, God, did he come and have the prawn sandwiches too late in the afternoon? But I think that wasn't the problem. But anyway, very sad, because he was a good guy. And then down south, David Lloyd at Conservative Hertfordshire, Sue Mount-Stevens, we had her picture up a minute ago, at Avon and Somerset, and Alan Michael, South Wales. So I don't know how typical those 9 are. As you can see, I've tried hard to sort of get the cross-section. In some respects, type of area as well as politics. But I think, you know, having talked about this research with lots of others, and the editor of the book that this is coming out in has also done a similar sort of Cook's tour of PCCs, I think the main messages that came out of this research seem to hold a wider sort of pattern too. So I just want to run through very briefly, just touch on those 5 accountabilities really. The accountability to voters and the wider public was inevitably the most interesting one. It's the most significant, I can tell you straight off. Very significant difference in the behaviour of PCCs from police authorities before. No one ever knew anything about police authorities very much. You might know them as councillors, you might know they were on the police authority, but rarely did they come to meetings as a member of the police authority. I have been a councillor since 2000. I never remember having had a police authority member talking to us councillors, even though they're councillors. But we've had the PCC, West Mercy PCC, 3 times at my local authority. They have really changed the dynamic and put themselves about. I've had a master's student just finished her dissertation on specifically on this topic about public accountability, public engagement. And it's the same story, really, that they're spending 2, sometimes 3 days a week out in meetings and visiting, still putting their gazebos up in the high street, the sort of things they did in the election, but they're still doing it regularly to sort of make themselves public, evening meetings galore, and so on. So at the time, I think you could easily say, well, this is just to get known after those embarrassing election routes, but it's still going on now. That was the point of my student's dissertation finding. She did that, she's done that. It's just about to be marked and presented to the exam board in a month's time, and she's still finding that. She works in the PC's office, so she's close to it. It's still very much how it is. So I think that's something that legislation didn't require this of PCCs, but they've all picked the habit up, and from, I think, probably prompted by the embarrassing beginning to the process, and have really made that their way of working. So in a sense, that might even explain why they've all got quite large offices of staff. They need people there to do the research and to do the, you know, the policy thinking, whilst they're doing very much this sort of outward facing thing. No doubt it will be have some payback when the elections come round again in 2017. But it's a rare example. It's often said of other politicians, I've just got elected again last week, that we only see you at election time, but it's not so with PCCs, was a clear finding here. So some of those comments really just capture the, what PCCs said of themselves. That might be a little bit arrogant. PCCs are set to become some of the most recognised public leaders in the country. I think I heard recently, that, you know, in the streets, sort of vox pop stuff, who's your PCC? Do you know what a PCC is? And it was embarrassing again to hear, even 2.5 years later, that it really hasn't sunk in into many minds. But there's something in that, that they're probably more likely to be, the name is likely to be recalled than most councillors. They are in the paper and on the radio, they're tweeting every day, all of them. They are sort of looking to make themselves well-known figures. Few more quotes, the same. Listening is what the job's all about. People say things to you in the street that they wouldn't say to you with a booked appointment, or if they come into the building. It's an interesting point, and you know that's in a sense why they continue to put themselves about and stick the gazebo up on Saturday mornings in the shopping areas and so on. And it was interesting, I don't know whether it was on the previous slide, that's right, the second one, the red one. The police themselves have been amazed at what this is producing in the way of complaints from the public. It seems to have generated, having a figure, a recognised figure, who's not the police, it's generated a huge amount of public comment that was never understood, picked up by the police themselves, let alone the police authority. So an interesting change, I think, in that, through that accountability relationship, in the nature of police governance, public understanding being picked up and as it were reflected into the process very effectively. I think that's a really positive thing. Police and crime panels, I touched on those earlier. What about this relationship? Well, this is a rather different story. Several of the police and crime panels that I talked again to some of the people as well as to the PCCs, some of the elected members there, I think there's a mutual feeling that these have been a bit of a damp squib. Perhaps not surprising, I think scrutiny is weak in local government generally, so in a sense in asking these to be effective in this new area of scrutinising police commissioners, was probably asking a lot. A number of other reasons, I think, go on. Because of the status of the PCC's office, the tendency, I think, in most places has been for the councils to then choose their nomination as their leader or a very senior figure, the portfolio holder for community safety or something, who's not necessarily an expert in scrutiny. They're platform people themselves. I suspect that's had a lot to do with it. They actually haven't sort of chosen necessarily the people who are best able to do this job well. But information asymmetry again, of course. You've got a full-time police and crime commissioner learning fast, you know, absorbing information, so on. Police and crime panels coming together intermittently, not knowing each other to start with, having to build a sense of community on their own body, their own panel. It was never going to succeed, was it really? And also sometimes former members of police authorities who want to carry on with that relationship, but again, being frustrated and often absent and sending a substitute. So all those, you know, characteristics of poor local government sort of playing themselves out here. Again, some of the comments of from the PCCs, I didn't hear any panel members say this of themselves, but the PCCs were pretty sceptical about what it was like. They attended the panels, obviously, and put themselves before the panels, but felt it was really going through the motions, not really very dynamic, not really feeling they were being held to account. Third one, the accountability. So that was a sort of a disappointment in a way. On the whole, I always think local government does scrutiny better when it's task and finish mode, and they, you know, small group work on a topic and really get to grips with it. And I think that might work better if the powers allowed them, and they don't, to really home in on a subject and do some serious scrutiny. The third one, accountability to central government. It's interesting. I for years in my sort of interest in criminal justice, I have always thought of the Home Office as a very centralist department. Always has been. They never wanted to let go in the way that the Department of Environment or DEFRA or whatever it became, you know, communities and local government, had about 20 names in my working life. But it was always the same. That was the department of, you know, general grant, unhypothecated and so on. Your local government, get on with it. But the Home Office was always, no, it's specific grant. 80% of the probation costs, we'll fund that and we'll keep control of it and so on. Police 50%, 51% and so on. But actually, so I, in a sense, my hypothesis was that Theresa May et al. Would actually want to keep a very firm grip on PCs, all the more so with all that trouble at the beginning that I talked about, because this was a prize policy area for the Conservatives. If it was all going, you know, unravelling before our very eyes, before the election, then immediately afterwards, all the more reason why you might have expected the Home Office to sort of come in heavy and sort of try and rescue it through steering it all. But not a bit of it, actually. They've managed to, perhaps because they thought it's better to leave it to the commissioners to commit suicide themselves than to take any responsibility for it. But a dangerous game, but that was the outcome, that the Home Office has sort of played a role of there to support when requested. Lots of audiences with Theresa and so on by PCCs, but actually letting them get on with the job in their own way. And there is a lot of difference in local offices and so on, which reflects that freedom that they've been given. So not terribly important change there, I think. Political sponsors. This I thought was going to be interesting too. As I said to you earlier, one of the main criticisms, objections to the idea of PCCs was this potential politicisation of policing, as if it never was politics, really, rather daft, but that was this concern. And that was very much picked up. I mean, this comment at the bottom was one of the Conservatives, a Conservative councillor, so someone who knew his politics very well. But, you know, they're clearly accepting the notion that actually once we've done the election and I'm the PCC, let's not think about politics here. Let's detach ourselves from that connection. And on the whole, I think they have done that very well. It's a bit like, you know, joining the judiciary, I think. You know, you sort of detach yourself from normal life and whatever your views are, you sort of become a little bit removed from the cut and thrust and so on. And I think certainly all the nine I met had that sort of air of, you know, slight distance from those around them. Certainly no evidence in my little research of a problem of sort of party politics showing through too much, at all, really. So this, to me, in a sense, was my evidence that was a theoretical problem that actually hasn't materialised. But what was interesting to me was actually how the party groupings did show themselves through in the sort of interest that the different different characters were showing. Certainly all three, I know it's not much of a sample to work with, but all three of them, different parts of the country, did speak in that sort of classic managerialist way about, you know, efficiency in policing and so on. Very critical, particularly one, of policing, you know, so they just don't know what strategy means. This is clearly someone who'd been on an MBA and got all the buzz and so on, and was horrified. His local authority, you know, had been doing this stuff for years, but he was horrified by what he was finding in the police service, and was on a mission really to sort of change it. They talk about strategy endlessly, but are not good at it. That must have hurt the chief constable to hear that comment made. Shambolic state of business, not policing itself, but the business of side of policing, shambolic. And that was the conservative sort of approach. All three of them were sort of wedded to this idea of shaping things up. They're also very interested in this, again, very much local government centred. All three were key conservative, if not leaders, deputy leaders of their authorities, of moving upstream, preventative, you know, so essentially efficiencies by avoiding crime. So they were very much into joining up with other services and, as it were, integration as a key concept. Whereas the Labour three, which included two ex-ministers, were talked much more about, you know, things in their patch, things, the problems that needed solving. They were much more, you know, attuned to the day-to-day, if you like. And so problem solving, and that was, I thought, rather fascinating. It's not to say that they weren't interested in preventative strategies and so on, moving upstream and so on, but that's what they talk much more about, real problems in the locality. Possibly, as the last point suggests, this was simply a reflection that the Labour areas are, you know, more city-centred, urban areas with more such problems. Difficult to say on this basis, but an interesting difference. And similarly, somewhere in the middle, those that had, I think, three with judicial sort of experience, magistrates and a former Crown Court judge. Very interesting that, you know, again, given the chance to speak freely about how they saw the role, you know, what they picked up on were issues, you know, classically you would associate with, you know, essentially a judicious mind and so on. So I thought that was rather interesting, but it certainly wasn't party politics in the sense that the arguments pre and immediately post had feared. And then the other, the fifth one, the final one, the reverse accountability. This is the PCC now as principal. Again, this was foreseen as being an area of considerable tension. The law that allows police chiefs, chief constables, operational independence. They're responsible for operational decisions. The PCC is only a strategic governor in that sense. But this was always going to be, you know, potentially a fiery dividing line, wasn't it? And so it was found that in all my areas, all nine areas, there had been, you know, a bit of sort of jockeying at the frontier, as it were, invasion by the PCC to, you know, into some operational issue, particularly some testing of the ground. But I think this is, again, in all cases, the relationships, apart from examples, Alan Hardwick falling out with his chief and so on, I think human nature and you know, politics and, you know, just as it were, necessary behaviours have allowed that relationship to sustain itself in pretty well every case, without, unless something has, you know, gone wrong, like finger in the till or some other indiscretion that's fired things up. On the whole, chief constables have been able to say, are you sure you think that's your, you know, legitimate job? Because it's my job. You know, they've managed the relationship really rather well. So again, I think, you know, from this little piece of research, I was heartened to think that actually, again, a theoretical problem is in practice has not been such a difficulty. And likewise, chief constables have been quite dignified and expectant about the legitimacy of the PCC you know, to set the things. If in the past I've watched so often chief constables just running rings around a police authority and, as it were, writing the plan for them. Here we are to sign it off together, but actually it was the chief constable's plan. It isn't like that anymore at all, and that's a sea change. And of course, obviously, most chief constables are only in office for 5 years. Soon we'll be in a position, we're nearly there now, where all the chief constables have been appointees of the PCCs. And that's a very different relationship that, you know, the old guard had to struggle with the imposition of a PCC over them. The new guard will know nothing else. So, again, mostly relationships good, apart from the flare-ups that I've touched on at the beginning. Most of them are managing to find daily contact with the chief and PCC, but actually sitting down together at regular intervals, maybe weekly, maybe fortnightly, and formally conducting, you know, an official meeting, a minuted meeting. So it's interesting. I did wonder, my hypothesis was actually rather cosy relationships might develop here, but none of those nine suggested to me that there was anything particular to worry about. They had all recognised the need for a lot of contact, but still took the time to do things differently on a regular basis. What surprised me out of all that is the last point, that most of the PCCs chose to site their offices in police headquarters. And as you'll know, most police headquarters are, you know, barriers, and it's like getting into Fort Knox, some of them. For understandable reasons on the cost front, but I, given all that outwardness I talked about, public facing approaches, I was surprised that most PCCs didn't say, I want a building that's out there, even if it's a corner of an old police station or something, which is what they have in Liverpool, Merseyside. She was in a sort of former police station in the community. But I suppose that is how they managed to have daily contact with the chief constable. To finish, time's up. Just a few conclusions really from all that. I hope that's been of interest. Certainly, of those five relationships, the first one with the voters and with the public is the all important one. That's what's really very different now than what was there before. Little indication of great competition in relation to the other accountabilities with that one. And what shines through for me, and again for my student dissertation this summer, is the importance of the personal dimension. In a sense, you know, we'd all been saying, how can one person possibly have a relationship and accountability with all these people in a vast police area? But actually, in a surprising sort of way, the personal, I don't want to say personality, but the personal dimension here is the most important. The putting themselves out and becoming a public figure that's name is personally known and face is personally recognised and so on is I think quite significant. Far too early even now, I think, to make any judgments about the impact. What's really different, how impactful are PCCs? I don't really know how to do that. Everything is changing all the time, so it's quite difficult to do the controlled experiment and consider whether PCCs do governance better. But there's certainly the trappings, as I've talked about, of a different approach, which I think has some healthy features about it. As I say, the last point is this one again about the visibility in all this. But finally, just to sort of make the comment really where I started thinking, I had excitement about the idea of high vis governance compared with police authorities, but I was never sure that one person was the right solution, the electocracy model. So I was saying it at the beginning, but actually quite recently, the Committee on Standards in Public Life, this is the Nolan Principles team, as it were, who have conducted a sort of commission of on PCCs. They're yet to report, but I went and had a sort of session with them in March. I thought they might be out pretty soon now. I think they were wrapping up then. But I think there's a moment in time shortly to come. That report could be quite a powerful shaper of the next, you know, the next adjustment, if you like. I don't think it'll be much more than an adjustment. But the idea of linking the directly elected PCC to a group of other councillors who would work with the PCC, sort of reinventing the police authority, but with a directly elected head, chair, lead, was one that, you know, I think, you know, is worth thinking about. And certainly the noises I got, that's why they wanted to talk to me, it seemed to fit with what the committee is wanting to see happen. And this, in a way, was sort of pioneered in the West Midlands. Bob Jones, I mentioned, the first thing he did, he got a lot of criticism for it, particularly about the expense of it, but he appointed a set of area assistants who were existing councillors and worked with him as a sort of team. But that sort of model seems, perhaps to bridge the gap between the benefits of someone who is full-time on the job and really getting, offering good leadership, but at the same time, inevitably somewhat out of touch with the mass of their area, even if they do put themselves about a lot. So that sort of middle ground solution is a real possibility, and I think it will get a push forward by the committee when it reports. And in a sense, that would, for me, would do away with the need for police and crime panels. I'm not sure scrutiny and support, as they've been cast in legislation to do, is ever going to work. It hasn't worked, in my experience, to date, and I doubt its future. But a committee like a police authority, but as I say, with a directly elected PCC, seems perhaps to have quite a lot of attraction for me, and I suspect for a few others too. That's it. Thank you.
We have a few minutes for questions. Part of the constraint is we only need to get you for a taxi.
Yeah.
Get you to back to Liverpool. Open it up.
But it's nice to see a case study based qualitative piece of research which has sort of got some new series of nuances to it. I'm particularly interested because I've been trying to do a similar thing with one of the fire services where the authority is still made up of councillors, and you had a sort of rather throwaway line about ineffectiveness.
Yeah.
And having sat through several long meetings where there are a set of long established councillors, longer established than the chief fire officer, who are surprisingly non-political about what they do, your conclusion at the end actually does strike a chord, though I think chief fire officers wouldn't like a commissioner because it would act as a threat, and I'm not sure I would describe it as running rings around, but the particular chief fire officer I'm thinking of is very, very skilled at operating in a meeting. It's not manipulation, but it's, you know, sensing what is, and certainly in one meeting, there was a case where a certain set of decisions which came out of management were accepted, and another set of proposals were very strongly rejected.
I mean, that's really helpful to hear. I'm on my police authority. One of the strange outcomes of becoming a county councillor is we have a joint police authority with Hereford and Worcester. And I found it a waiting case study, really. It is a very funny place, the fire authority, because there's this overlay, I guess you have it to an extent in police, but it's more acutely obvious in fire, of, how can I describe it, really? Just so much ceremony, and when a fire officer dies in a fire, obviously a tragedy, but we all stand as though he's our brother or something, and just the sort of embodiment of that, and it's captured in, as you say, these long-serving councillors have always been on the police or the fire authority long before the chair. And you're right, our fire chief plays it very well, in sort of showing respect and dignity. There's a sort of mutual climate, you know, atmosphere that just works so well, but it's absolutely useless. You know, it's not, doesn't really, don't make a decision at all, really. So we go through the motions. I'm on the audit and, for my pains, audit and whatever else, something else. So boring and it's so pointless. It's governance at its worst for me. But of course, just back to your starting point, you know, that has been one of the echoes in the sidelines here, isn't it? That fire and ambulance, you know, the blue light services might all come together under the commissioner or the mayor or whatever it's going to be. So, I mean, we may yet get there.
Mm. Can I suggest we take the two together?
I give a slight air of hostility. I spent 9 years as a member of the Merseyside Police Authority, and currently I'm still a member of the Independent Audit Committee of Merseyside Police, something which seems to have slipped off your slides altogether, of independent audit and how they work. Yeah. I didn't really recognise the description of police authorities that you gave me at all. Yeah. And I'm quite surprised that apart from talking about visibility, you actually return to the notion of police authorities, having previously dismissed them as being ineffective, and so you can't have both of those things.
Okay.
But what certainly interests me, and again, it's something that's not here, is what increasingly has happened since the values work that's gone on, is the increase by many commissioners and chief officers of the growth of ethical committees, and the way the ethical committees have come into the game in terms of accountability. I obviously have very distinct views around police authorities and the relative merits of police authorities and police commissioners, but I am interested in certainly in the notional idea of having a broad band of people who can be summoned to talk about what the PCC in Greater Manchester calls those grey areas, those things that fall between the cracks in relation to the relationship between a PCC, the public, and chief constables.
Yeah,
because that's such a direct.
Yeah.
Do you want to respond to that?
Yeah, I'd love to. And I want to say too, although I hadn't got a lot of time for the police authorities I'd had experience of, I did go to Merseyside and was immediately saw it was somewhere else compared with West Midlands, for example. Its own building out there. You'd had Merseyside Police Authority in the carpet, I remember, didn't it? The wonderful swathes of carpet. But that's not the point I'm making. It's clear that the Merseyside Police Authority was trying to be in the community and, as it were, be separate. We never ever got, and even now have never got, West Midlands out of Lloyd House. You know, they've stayed well behind the police. And lots of others similarly go through the motions. So I'm sure there are examples, and I say, I remember clocking Merseyside as interesting because they clearly did take the public seriously. They've, you know, got a proper room with a public gallery. I've sat in it. So yeah, sorry if I've dismissed all. Yeah.
Do you want to respond? I mean, are you asking
about ethics committees, really, about the growth of ethics committees, and we see that?
I think I'll just take your point. I don't really know enough to say any more than you've said, but I think you're right. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I know you didn't look at this directly, which is the other side of the triangle between the Home Office and the Chief Constables, but I wondered whether you'd picked up in talking to the PCCs anything about how they saw that impacting, because you've got another agent. Principal relationship there, haven't you, and long-standing one.
To whom?
Chief Constable to the Home
Office. Yeah, sorry, the other side of the triangle.
I just wondered whether in talking to the PCCs, you know, they'd meant, because you said that they had, obviously, were surprised they had good relationships with the Home Office, but whether that other side of the triangle impacted upon what they could and couldn't do, and constrain them in some ways.
I think, I mean, the chief constable home secretary relationship, you know, hasn't changed. What obviously would be potentially different is the relationship between a police authority and home secretary and an individual PCC. But as I said, what I was finding really is that the Home Office has very definitely put itself in a position, we're here if you need us, but actually you can get on with this in your own way, and that seems to have been what's happened nationwide. And as I said, all the more surprising because I think the history of the Home Office, you would have expected, and particularly with some of the debacles early on, that they might well have seen it as a damage limitation by, as it were, taking control early on, but they seem not to have done that.
Could I ask you, in terms of the people you were interviewing, PCCs, was there any difference in terms of how they were describing their relationships or how you observed their relationships, either with the authority or with the chief constables, that had anything to do with their previous backgrounds? So you have Jane Kennedy and Louis Blan and Michael and Wales, Tony Lloyd in Greater Manchester. I know you didn't go to Greater Manchester, but here you've got politicians with
national
profile, national experience.
Ministerial experience.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it's more or less, as I said it really, more significant to what I felt I was hearing was a concern with locality and the community's problems, whereas the Conservatives, there were no ministers in my Conservative group, but they were all local government senior politicians, so and in Conservative land. So they had come into this new role with essentially a well-prepared understanding of the notion of public service integration, and were wanting to apply that in the policing sort of mission. That's about it really. As I said, I don't think for a moment that the Jane Kennedys of this world didn't share that thing, but it was just interesting that they preferred to talk to me about the problems. And she was a case in point, really, as having put herself not in the police headquarters, but in the community. Alan Michael just doesn't stop talking.
No, I know that. I'm betting.
And sat there all day.
Just those are 2 points, really. How do you see the turnout going next time round in 2016?
Good question.
And also, we talked a lot about accountability of holding the chief constable account and representing the public's views.
Yeah.
But one of the things you haven't touched upon is the commissioning side.
Yeah.
And with PCCs now having commissioning responsibilities for victim services, it'd be interesting to see how the public grasp that and hold PCCs to account for the services that they are providing and commissioning.
I fear for the turnout next time, but it will be with the local government elections. That was the problem the first time, November. Not just the weather, but there were no other elections in pretty well all but one place, I think. Bristol, I think, had some. So, what was going to get people out when they didn't understand what they were voting for and all the rest of it? I think it will, like it was for the local elections last week, the general election effect helps local government. We had 73% turnout, I'd get 37% rather than 73%. So it'll be better, but only because voters went to do something else, and that's get their local authority elections. And there are probably some areas where there won't be that, so it'll be embarrassing again. I don't think, I don't think there's great appetite in the public to elect police commissioners. It's too complicated an idea for them. Second part of your question, what was?
Commissioning.
Yeah. I don't think that will caption the public interest either. yes, they've got the role. I think my understanding is that they're taking it in a very sort of business-like way, as commissioning mostly is done, and it's not exercising. At least I'm not getting a sense that it's exercising any sort of frisson of public interest. Really, there are probably some very disappointed victim support workers as contracts are being lost. I hear quite a lot of bad press. I've done a lot of work with victim support, so I know the good work they do as well, but they seem to have been vilified a little bit in many areas as not doing the job that needs doing. So I think a lot, there will be some big changes there, but I'm not sure that will ever reach the public mood either. So I think that's an internal issue. Have you got a thought about that? What are you... think you obviously know.
I work for Jane Kennedy. I'll come clear, everybody. But I did serve under the police authority previously, so I've got I've got a bit of experience of both. I think it's a massive amount of money. I think £5 million we receive for victim services.
Yeah,
and it's so disappointing and frustrating that the public just don't seem to be interested in
the
it.
Significance of it.
Because there's a lot of accountability around that money and where it goes.
Absolutely,
and is it based on proper decisions? Or is it based on who gets the foot in the door first?
I think so, but I don't know. I suppose I think commissioning victim services is more likely to produce the better outcomes for victims than what we had before, where essentially, you know, there was a monopoly. As I say, I've done a lot of work for victim support and admire most of it. I think it is now changing, isn't it? Yeah. It's going to be a much more fragmented service. It was a terrible irony, wasn't it, really, that victim support, you know, the organisation victim support was sort of made to nationalise itself. The federation was destroyed because the national politicians said we only want to deal with one organisation, and two or three years later it's sort of scrapped. So there must be a lot of people in victim support who curse that that change that took place. Otherwise they would have had more discretion and more.
I suppose the risk is, I don't know enough about Merseyside, but I think in Greater Manchester there certainly seems to be, through the office, an attempt to develop a relationship with the not-for-profit sector and the voluntary sector, which I think is qualitatively different than that which had existed beforehand. So again, I don't know if that's true from your perspective, but I think that maybe leads to greater awareness amongst, if you like, the professionalised voluntary sector about what is happening, the potential, on the positive as well as the cuts, but that's not shared by the wider public, because they're not those kinds of things that are necessarily discussed, whereas number of police officers on the beat, rates of crime, etc.
And I mean, I agree with that, but at the same time, I also look at, what's happened in probation, and just wonder whether, it just takes the particular minister with like Grayling with his agenda, that victim services too could end up in a, essentially in a sort of commercial context. Right now, you're right, the favouring the local, local third sector, but for how long?
I'm conscious of the time. Is that, have we kind of got to a natural? Is that okay? Because I'm conscious of the need. I need to get into the taxi. Can I thank you very much for coming though? I really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
We will make the presentation available on the I4P, the Institute for Public Policy and Professional Practice website, so people can download and see it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.